when he and the Minister of State, Mr. Godi Jedi Agba, went on an inspection visit to the plant recently, was briefed by the officials handling the project that it was at 86% completion level.
We are out for inspection and we are going around and everything is going fine at the moment. We just want to encourage the contractors to hasten up and finish the project. And that is our mission of coming out to inspect.
Still briefing newsmen, Engineer Mamman said he is still inspecting all ongoing power projects before his evaluation. He, however, assured that the ministry is working towards improving power supply to Nigerians by completing major power projects during the present administration.
We just have to visit all and see and then add up everything together and see whether we are meeting up. But I want to assure you that this is the next level movement anyway. Our next level movement in this power sector, in this Ministry of Power, is to make sure that all these projects have been completed. We are going around to complete the project and also to commission the project before the end of this term.
He also said aside from increasing generation capacity, the Kudenda Power Station will be providing voltage support to Kaduna, Kano and Jos, which will improve the electricity distributed to the consumers.
By the time this is completed, we're going to power Kaduna, Kano and Jos at the same time, thinking we're going to get uninterrupted.
The Minister of State, Mr. Agba, on his part, said he was impressed with the level of work that has been done at the power plants.
By the time we finish all the inspections, we will aggregate what has been seen. We can at that point give you projections as to completion. But we are committed in this next level to giving power to the masses of Nigeria.
Earlier, the contractor's representative, Engineer Sonny Okwedi, who conducted the dignitaries on the power plant's inspection, mentioned the status of the projects, adding that the power control module, PCM, was awaiting installation.
Now it's up to 86% complete.
86%.
Are you sure it's up to 86?
Yes.
What is the...
There is nothing left here, just...
No.
That will be planned.
Yes.
But for individual, it's 27.875 megawatts. So we are happy it going into the PCM, power control module. The power generated will now go from the power control module into the switchyard. From there, we feed either Mandu or we feed a local network that will now feed Kaduna Metropolis. So that is the way the job is. As of now, we have finished the flushing of this GT.
The managing director of the transmission company of Nigeria, TCN, Mr. Usman Gur Muhammad, during the inspection visit said the company was working with the ministry to complete the transmission line that will evacuate electricity from the power plants.
All the process have been completed now, and I can assure you, I hope that before the end of this year, we should finish the transmission line.
We'll do that.
If you look at the tower foundation, 90% of them have been done. So I think the biggest problem we have now is for the contractor to bring the conductors and restrain them, and I believe that will is easier than building the towers. So that's where we are. It's in our interest, it's in the interest of TCN that this substation, this power plant work, because it provides voltage support to this Kaduna and Kano. And which is very critical to the stability of the grid.
Briefing newsmen, Mr. Muhammad re-echoed the calls for the recapitalization of the distribution companies, DISCOs, so they can have more grounds to match the investment TCN is making in transmission.
In reality, all over the nation, how many injection substations and how many distribution feeders have been built? You will see that there's none. And that is why we are saying that DISCOs have to be capitalized. As we speak with you, I can conveniently tell you that TCN is capitalized because we have completed a $300 million project and we are embarking or implementing $1.661 billion of project.
He revealed the ongoing plan of TCN to build several transmission lines in Kaduna State as part of its Transmission Rehabilitation and Expansion Program, TREP, to strengthen bulk power evacuation in the nearest future.
We are building several lines to come to Kaduna. We are reconstructing the single circuit line from Shiroro to Kaduna. We are putting a quad line. We are completing a 330 double circuit line, which is about 98% completed, from Jos to Kaduna.
The Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer of the Transmission Company of Nigeria, TCN, Mr. Usman Gur Mohammed, recently led the Minister of Power, Engineer Salim Maman, the Minister of State, Mr. Godi Jedi Agba, and other officials of the Federal Ministry of Power to inspect transmission substations in Kaduna.
They are the ongoing Kudenda substation, which will evacuate power from the 215 megawatts Kudenda Thermal Power Station, and the Mando substation, which will inject parts of the generated power into the national grid to improve bulk power supply nationwide. At the Mando transmission substation, Mr. Mohammed, in the company of the Minister of Power, addressed newsmen on the impact of the new Kudenda transmission substation project and the ongoing expansion project at the Mando substation. He said,
"The Kudenda substation is a power plant that we have in Kudenda. So we need to evacuate the power plant to the grid. And that's why we are building this line from here to Kudenda. We are building a 330 kV line, but it's going to be energized at 120. The reason is that there's expected expansion of that place. And when it expands, it will need to be evacuated at 330. So instead of us to wait that time, start building 330, it takes a long time to build a line. So we're building a 330, but we're evacuated at 132.
He noted that the project will harness power generation from Kaduna Power Plants, Gurara Hydro Power Plants, and will upgrade the Mando substation at 132 kV level to supply more bulk power to industrial and domestic consumers in Kaduna.
You know, this Gurara line that also came to Kudenda. It means that if we synchronize this place to Kudenda, we are synchronizing up to Gurara. So that's what it means.
On the completion level of the various projects for both substations, he said,
"This project, in terms of the foundations for that line from here to Kudenda, is about 90% complete. We have few places between from here, around here and around Kudenda where we have right-of-way issues. We have devised a strategy to solve that problem."
According to him, TCN has plans to make Kaduna a hub for power transmission by creating redundant power transmission lines that will ensure there is backup for power evacuation.
"And we are now putting what we call N-2 in Kaduna. By the time we complete the Kayenji, Brininkebi, Sokoto, Katsina line, Kaduna is going to be N-3 in terms of line. That means if three lines goes out of Kaduna, Kaduna will still receive supply. And that's what we are doing. We want to modernize the electricity industry in such a way that we can have a stable grid just like you have in any part of the world."
Commending the ministers on the inspection tour, Mr. Mohammed said they are leaders who are results-oriented.
"You can see my two honorable ministers, they just came on board, and you see they have started hitting the ground running. Last time we went to Kashimbila, now we are here. Our ministers are ministers that are not office ministers. They are ministers that want to see results. And they are challenging us to work hard, and we are going to work hard to deliver and ensure that we put N-1 across the country. We want to solve all the problem of transmission because we are implementing the transmission administration expansion program, which you know is putting N-1 across the country."
Let's take a break for a message. Please stay tuned.
Do not build under transmission power lines for your safety and health. Electricity power lines and substations, either for power transmission or power distribution services, are extremely dangerous when exposed to direct human contact. These power lines and substations transmit electricity that lights up our homes and offices, power our computers, TVs, and refrigerators. On the other hand, the same electricity, when exposed, is extremely dangerous. It can shock, electrocute, and kill anyone on its way. That is why everyone must adopt safety measures whenever we use or are close to electricity facilities like power lines or substation or transformers. For the safety of the people and animals, governments all over the world have approved way leave or right of way of 50 meters for 330 kV power lines and 30 meters for 132 kV power lines and 33 kV lines, the way leave is 15 meters. People are not expected to be found within this way leave or right of way for safety reasons. The lines can suddenly cut and fall to the ground with very disastrous consequences such as fire and electrocution of anybody and destruction of anything, be it vehicle, houses or vegetation on its line. It has also been established that power lines and substation emit electromagnetic fields, EMF, which is dangerous to human health. The World Health Organization, WHO, has warned that people who spend long hours under or close high-tension lines stand the risk of being affected by EMF and be vulnerable to cancer, leukemia in children, miscarriages among pregnant women, and other terrible diseases. It is therefore advisable not to build any structure or operate any business under or near any electricity high-tension lines or substations. TCN wants you to stay alive, stay safe, stay healthy, avoid power lines. This message is from the Management of Transmission Company of Nigeria, TCN.
Power sector experts in Nigeria and other ECOWAS countries at a recent meeting in Abuja have committed to supporting the grid synchronization project of the West African Power Pool, WAP, where the various power systems of the 14 member countries will be interconnected to enable a seamless regional electricity trading.
At the closing session of the three-day grid synchronization meeting organized by the West African Power Pool, WAP, the Managing Director, CEO of the Transmission Company of Nigeria, TCN, and Chairman, Board of Directors of WAP, Mr. Usman Gur Muhammad, urged the participants to be committed to the success of the project.
We all agree that we are going to ensure the project succeeds. Now, if we agree that the project succeeds, then that means there are certain requirements that we have to do. There are some requirements for data that you are supposed to provide. And there are some also requirements that you will also work with GE to ensure that we did what we are supposed to, we do what we are supposed to do. This is very important because, as you know, in the whole of your course, WAP is the only institution that is working very well. And we intend to maintain that tempo. We want WAP to be, continue to be a success story.
He noted that experts from various power firms across the West African sub-region should look beyond success towards developing innovative strategies for sustaining the success of a synchronized power grid.
If you don't know how to manage your success, you will descend and you'll be worse than the person who is actually not successful. So it means that if we want to continue to maintain this tempo of our success, we have to continue to work hard. And I'm happy to tell you, as the chairman of the executive board, even language is not a barrier in WAP. If you look at the court, we have never had any serious rancor among us. We don't have rancor. And if there's anybody who creates problems, we always come together to solve the problem.
A representative of the Nigerian Agip Oil Company, or Pire Generation Company, in Delta State, Engineer Raphael Onushakpo, commended WAP for hosting the meeting as he assured of his company's support towards the overall success of the project.
The entire sit-out has been very effective and quite articulate, and we would like to thank you, and we assure you, in my case, on behalf of my company, that we will support this initiative because it will clearly add value to our systems and the systems of our neighboring countries. Thank you very much.
In a recap about the impacts of the meeting, the head transmission service provider TSP at TCN, Engineer Victor Adewumi, said the member countries of WAP have different voltage levels but are making the efforts to synchronize them.
So the principal objective of this workshop is to make sure we put all those things that will be required to make us, you know, interconnect, to be able for us to be able to get interconnected together seamlessly without any problem, which means the generators must be able to synchronize together. And the generators synchronizing together, some certain conditions should be met. So we have a consultant that is driving that process, and there is need for the consultant to know what we have at every point. So that in a nutshell, that is the principal aim of this workshop, to see that we can interconnect together seamlessly so that at the end of the day we'll be on a single grid.
The Senior Engagement Manager, Sub-Saharan Africa, General Electric Consulting Firm for the WAP Grid Synchronization Network, Engineer Patrick John Sampson, said he was impressed about the level of commitment of participants throughout the meeting.
What I got from this meeting this week is more of commitment. The success of the synchronization project hinges on how committed the TSOs, the transmission system operators, our plant operators, and GE as the consulting company work together. And I got the commitment of each and everyone, and we are going to be working together to ensure that the entire sub-region is interconnected. Ask ourselves, what's the benefit of us getting interconnected? We give the opportunities for excess power in different parts of the region to be shared equally and improve poverty, alleviate any form of poverty that we have in the region.
The quest to accelerate the pace of work at the Gagarawa transmission substation in Jigawa State topped the agenda of the Managing Director, CEO of the Transmission Company of Nigeria, Mr. Usman Guru Mohammed, recently when he visited the substation, along with his team for a first-hand assessment of the level of work. Powerwheel brings you the details.
Mr. Mohammed inspected a 2x60 MVA capacity transmission substation in company of the head transmission service provider, TSP Engineer Victor Adewumi, the General Manager Transmission Services Engineer Idris Alim, and other officials of TCN. The TCN boss, who briefed pressmen at the substation site, said the slow pace of work at the substation had made the company to re-strategize by planning to take over the project from the contractor and have it completed within the shortest time by the TCN in-house engineers. He said a meeting has been scheduled with the contractor to further action.
The government took a decision to do this road for us, the governor of Jigawa said. But you see, if you look at this work now, there are several of them that can be done even without road. If you look at the cabling, if you look at several things, including these panels that are supposed to be put inside the control room, those things are supposed to be done even without road, you can do this. So it shows that this contractor has not been very serious. So I've directed that the contractor should come and meet me in the office.
Addressing a question on the capacity of a substation to serve customers, Mr. Mohammed clarified that transmission substations only supply bulk power to distribution companies, DISCOs, who deliver them to the end users and final consumers.
This is a 2x60 MVA transformer, which means the capacity of this place is almost, I think it's slightly higher than the capacity of Hadeja. So you see what it is. Hadeja, that is an old substation. This substation is going to be higher than the one of Hadeja. So it's a big power supply. It's even bigger than Dutse.
We're bringing you more reports in the Power Flash segment. Please don't go away. You're welcome to the feedback segment. Here are comments on our feedback segment for this edition. On our Facebook page, we have the following comments. The post on the misrepresentation of crucial power grid operational data by the Association of Nigerian Electricity Distributors, published on September 19th, 2019, got 13 likes and one comment. 12 people shared the post. The comment, which was by Engineer Mutali Boladali, a Facebook user, says, "Thanks for the update." The governor of Plateau State, Honorable Simon Bako Lalong, recently paid courtesy visit to the MD/CEO of TCN, Mr. Yuji Mohammed, and the management team, where they discussed strategies to improve bulk power supply in the state. The visit, which was at TCN headquarters in Abuja on 17th September, got 84 people liking the post, 19 people sharing it, and 4 others commenting on it. Beatrice Dangpe Samben says, "This is the earnest desire of the Plateau Man. The completion of 132-33 kV transmission substation Pangshin. We're praying for the successful execution of this project. Right on, Mr. Governor." Another Facebook user, Ngolong Samson, says, "It's our newest prayers that your visit to TCN headquarters will facilitate the completion of the long-awaited 132-33 kV TCN line in Pangshin." Abdullahi Suleiman simply mentioned Makeri Pangshin line. In what seems to be a plea, Solex Izzy Ayiki says, "Pangshin, TCN, please." On the Twitter page, TCN tweeted the actual data on power allocation to Kano Disco and its actual uptake from TCN, which it published on August 29, 2019. The tweet had 14 comments, 48 likes, and 36 people retweeted it. Engineer Okwe Omenka tweeted this: "The format of data should be consistent. I think the customers need to see this data. Please do same for other discos. And why is this load rejection rampant now?" asked a tweeter identified as Charles. In his tweet, Michael Adeniyi was says, "Let TCN publish this on pages of newspapers to expose the inefficiency of KEDCO. All these discos are not viable. Federal government should withdraw their licenses." TCN tweeted about the capacity upgrade of the old Abeokuta 132-33 kV transmission substation from 90 MVA to 150 MVA. It stated that Ibadan Electricity Distribution Company now has more electricity for its customers. This tweet drew reactions from tweeters. There are 3 comments, 14 retweets, and 37 likes. AT Adudu tweeted this: "Now, IBEDC doesn't have excuse for not giving out supply with the new upgrade from TCN." Folari Bello tweeted, "I hope they will peak load on the transformer as expected of them." Commending TCN, Goni Abubakar Mohammed tweeted this: "Up TCN. We are delighted to hear from you, our audience. Your comments show that our message is truly got to you. Please keep commenting." We appreciate you for sticking with us on this program. Join us next week on the same station for a refreshing edition of Power Wheel. This episode and the previous ones are available on our YouTube channel. You can also connect with us on these other platforms showing on your screen. I am Chinwenwa Anyao. See you next time.
If you make 10 tops by this time next week, sharp, sharp.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But
okay. Talk later.
You won't get money now.
Hurry up!
My pikin, how you day?
Papa, I say make I remind you about that loan.
Loan, I beg.
Hello, Papa.
Your move.
Hello, sister of life. I won't remind you of that loan. Hello?
The number cannot be reached now.
Hello, Oga. Your clothes are ready.
Are you an entrepreneur looking for financing to grow your business? Here's good news. Development Bank of Nigeria now provides sustainable financing through commercial banks, microfinance banks, and other financial institutions with repayment terms of up to 10 years. Please do remember, paying back your loan in good time will give you access to more loans.
Development Bank of Nigeria. Financing sustainable growth.
Right quality, right thickness. That's what Total Aluminium gives you. No matter the size of your project, Total Aluminium gives you the specifications that suit your needs, from long-span aluminium roof and cladding sheets, step tiles, stone chip coated, and metcopo roof tiles. All these are working for one purpose, and with the newly acquired technology, Total Aluminium ensures your structure gets the roofing that would stand the test of time. Come rain, come shine. Total Aluminium Systems Limited.
They offer you efficient customer service.
When malaria come knock for your door, he hits you face to face. No grief for ammo. Well, they are fast, fast with public term. He get a Termiter plus to make a trim. Pop, pop, pop. Public term. Pop, pop, pop.
Oral suspension for children. Tablet for adults.
Oya make you work out for malaria. They make you younger with public term. Public term get a Termiter plus lumefantrine to help you work out for malaria side. Public term, they available for pharmacies near you.
Public term get NAFDAC approval. The number now be 4-0-2-0-2.
Public term. Na product of Publix Pharmaceuticals Nigeria Limited. Part of Publix Healthcare UK Limited. Publix Pharmaceuticals Nigeria Limited. Good health for your domot. If symptoms persist after 3 days,
Nigeria.
Rainy season gradually winds down, many Nigerians are counting their losses occasioned by flooding that characterized this season. Now join us as we look at flooding, its mitigation and management of inherent devastation. Have a good evening and welcome to the program. Flooding has been reported in parts of Nigeria since the inception of 2019 rainy season. Virtually all predictions by both Nigeria Hydrological Agency and NIMET came to pass, with flooding events recorded in over 28 states of the Federation. Beginning from the 3rd of August this year, many states in the northern parts of the country experienced a devastating flooding, leaving houses and crops destroyed and of course causing some fatalities. Rainstorm and flooding affected parts of Adamawa, including the city of Yola. Also in early August, heavy rainfall inundated the capital city of Abuja, with further rains worsening the flood situation. Many communities in Niger, Kogi, Borno, Yobe, Jigawa, and others, especially some IDP camps, were affected, and the victims needing special humanitarian services. Down south, the story remained the same, Lagos, Anambra, Oyo, Ogun, Imo, Delta, Abia, and many other southern states experienced volumes of rains and associated flooding, increasing vulnerabilities in the areas affected. Majority of victims of this year's flooding are said to require emergency shelters and household supplies such as water, hygiene kits, food items, and bathing facilities. Observers say there is the need for interagency collaboration and prompt response to these flood victims who, according to reports, are already receiving attention. Now, how much of this attention is impacting the victims, and how has the National Emergency Management Agency been handling these very huge and complex rescue and management operations required to fully assist the victims? Our guest today is the Director General of NEMA, Mustafa Mehaja. My name is Kirian Umayo. Thank you for tuning in to the program. This is Weekend File. We now begin with the news. President Muhammadu Buhari is back in Abuja after a successful and significant outing at the 74th session of the United Nations General Assembly in New York. State House correspondent Adamu Samba reports that the president, accompanied by the governors of Nasarawa and Osun states, arrived in Nnamdi Azikiwe International Airport, Abuja, in the early hours of Saturday. The Minister of Foreign Affairs, Geoffrey Onyema, and some personalities on the president's entourage described Nigeria participation in the general debate and other high-level side events of the Global Forum as remarkably outstanding.
It was a source of great pride, you know, to everybody. It really showed that Nigeria is really taking the initiative and being proactive in a lot of the areas that will help Nigeria to attain the objectives, the sustainable development goals, and also as a model for other countries. Mr. President really dwelt on the substance, you know, security issues, but very importantly, sustainable development goals that Nigeria is making very concrete efforts to address, eradicating extreme poverty, and the steps, social investment programs that Nigeria is taking to address these, and you know, security issues and steps we are taking. And so it was really a very, very good overview.
I have with a few people that I've met, you know, it's quite quite instructive. For instance, the issue of the SDG, the 17 goals of the SDG, once one starts to address those goals, that is the way to actually ensure that you have opportunity of bringing some development to the people generally. There must be collective action in respect of poverty eradication. Poverty is not the good thing to anybody. Poverty breeds war. When people have things to eat, when they live a normal life, they are not likely to be involved in crime.
The situation we find ourselves in Nasarawa is similar to one of the issues discussed during the SDG presentation. We are fighting a security challenge by going to the root cause of the security in the first place. We are embracing the National Livestock, you know, Transformation Project. Identifying, in fact, Nasarawa has more locations than any of the seven pioneer states, you know, that are approaching it. So we're taking it from that angle. We're also doing a lot of advocacy, a lot of sensitization for people to understand the importance of living in peace. We have to find Nigeria's solutions to our Nigerian challenges.
Well, that's the interview is conducted by Adamu Sambo, just back from New York. Nigerian governors are committing to broadening their implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs, as well as the Paris Agreement on Climate Change as part of the drive towards improving the living standards of citizens in the country, particularly at the grassroots. At a roundtable discussion on the role of subnational governments in achieving the SDGs and the Paris Agreement, Agreement on Climate Change held on the sidelines of the 74th General Assembly in New York, the governor said they understand clearly the challenge of implementing these crucial programs, but will not shy away from looking for solutions within and outside the country to ensure that the programs are fully implemented.
Now, at the level of the Nigerian Governors Forum, which is, of course, a pressure group of all the 36 governors in Nigeria, we have a peer review mechanism that is being extended to this issue to help monitor how we're doing, both in terms of our budgetary allocations to these issues and in terms of the implementation at the local level. Because
I have done as a way of legacy projects to establish primary schools of international standard, secondary school of international standard, and also health institutions of international standards in all the local governments. And I hope that that will uplift my tenure, so that by the time I leave that place, if you are talking of international school, you will have one in every local government.
Erosion, landsliding, and flooding have become the issues that the people, you know, have had to learn how to live with. Especially its consequences. In the southeast, you have a lot of solid gully erosion, flooding, and landslides, and that are responsible for widespread destruction of human lives, and animal lives, plant lives.
As part of a commitment to accelerate the pace of development in Imo State, Governor Emeka Ihedioha held a strategic business meeting with officials of the United Nations Development Program, UNDP, in New York. Governor Ihedioha, who was part of the Nigeria Governors Forum delegation to the 74th United Nations General Assembly, called on the UNDP to assist Imo State in the areas of youth development, job and wealth creation, environment, renewable energy, e-governance, tourism, and agribusiness. The leader of the UNDP team, Ms. Ahunna Onoche, who is also Regional Director, UNDP Regional Bureau for Africa, highlighted the natural resources that abound in the state, adding that the UNDP is willing to support the state to harness the resources. Now, the Buhari Media Organization says the directive by President Muhammadu Buhari that budgets of government-owned enterprises are captured in the nation's annual budget is a welcome idea. A statement by the chairman of the organization, Nii Akinsilu, the move, which was captured in the 2020-2022 medium-term expenditure framework and fiscal strategy paper, will bring sanity to government operations in more ways than one. The group also hailed the president for keeping to his pledge of submitting the MTF FSP early enough to ensure that the budget cycle is returned to the January-December fiscal year. In addition, BMO commended the National Assembly leadership for promptly forwarding the MTF FSP to the finance committees of the two chambers with a mandate to submit a report within 1 week. Among news now, President Muhammadu Buhari has reacted to the reported rescue of 400 persons in a building in Kaduna where the detainees were allegedly abused and tortured. The center, which has been widely described as a house of torture and a place of human slavery, the president says he is glad that Muslim authorities have dismissed the notion of Islamic school about the embarrassing and horrifying event, while commending the police for discovering the den. President Buhari condemns the abuse of rights under any form and reiterates the federal government's commitment to ensuring that every child goes to school. To stop unwanted cultural practices that amount to the abuse of children, the statement adds that religious and traditional authorities must work with the federal, state, and local governments to expose and stop all forms of abuses that are widely known but ignored for many years by communities. Now, Nigeria has been re-elected as a part two member of the International Civil Aviation Organization, ICAO Council, for a new three-year term. In a statement issued on Friday, September 27th, by James Daudu, Director of Public Affairs, Federal Minister of Aviation, Nigeria got 151 votes out of the 193 member states, 18 more than it did in 2016. Reacting to the feat, Minister of Aviation Hadi Sirika was excited by this feat, saying the success goes to show that Nigeria is on course in its transformation agenda for the aviation sector. Meanwhile, the Nigerian Civil Aviation Authority has banned the carrying of MacBook Pro or Pro model Retina 15 MID 2015 on board with immediate effect. A statement by the Director of Operations and Training of the Authority, AMCD. This is because the product has been recalled by the manufacturer due to battery problems. This presents a risk to aviation safety due to overheating. All airline operators are expected to comply. The House of Representatives Ad Hoc Committee investigating abandoned projects in the power sector has directed the Permanent Secretary in the Minister of Power to appear before it on Wednesday, October 2nd, 2019, with documents on the current status of the Mambila Power Project. The Transmission Company of Nigeria and the Niger Delta Power Holding Company were also issued similar directives by the committee. National Assembly correspondent Vivian Idepefo reports.
Following public outcry on the performance of the power sector and in view of government's investments to improve service delivery, this investigative public hearing is to ascertain why results are slow despite all efforts.
The committee is at liberty, in line with sections 88 and 89 of the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, 1999 as amended, which is the grand norm of the land, to invite any organization, agency, person, either still in active service or retired, to make clarifications where necessary.
Deputy Chairman of the Ad Hoc Committee, Bello Usman Kumo, sought answers from stakeholders present.
Getting this money is through appropriation and generation, IGR generation, because there is a specific, a small fraction of a percentage that's supposed to go to you. That you refuse to tell us.
TCN operates three licenses: transmission services provision license, the systems operations license, and the market operations license. All these licenses are subject to NERC regulation, and NERC defines the tariff that they charge for these three services.
Members of the Ad Hoc Committee raised observations on issues such as insurance of substations, compensation on right-of-way, and the death of a contractor, which resulted to a stalled project. The Ad Hoc Committee expressed displeasure at the inability of the agencies to respond clearly to some issues raised, and requested the agencies to submit audited accounts accompanied by relevant documents for proper guidance. From the National Assembly, Vivian Idekwefo, NTA News.
The contribution of women in the maritime space is crucial to economic growth and development. But to bridge the gender gap within the industry, experts are proposing incentive strategies and proclamation of more affirmative action. This formed the nucleus of discussion at an event to commemorate World Maritime Day in Lagos. Michael Olale reports.
The promotion of sustainable shipping and maritime development are some of the major priorities of the International Maritime Organization, IMO, in the coming years. Achieving the mandate no doubt required the collaborative and progressive impulse of major players, the female folk inclusive. Sadly, just 2% of world's total 1.2 million seafarers are women, a statistic which the IMO observed is below par if the global community must tap immensely from the wealth in the maritime sector.
Nigeria should continue to support our women by agreeing on a specific number to be sponsored annually to programs in the World Maritime University.
Within the Nigerian Maritime Contest, various organizations are joining the vanguard of increasing women participation using viable platforms.
We have an Africa Leadership Development Program that makes sure that every year we have at least 50% women participating.
It is important that government engage stakeholders in the sector
to design measures and modalities for the engagement of more women in shipping activities and other areas with the maritime.
Minister of Transportation declared that women are entitled to assume enviable positions, but they should devise the best approaches in achieving the goals.
All of us put our hands together, we can lift 10 million Nigerians out of.
Apart from recognizing women who have contributed to the growth of the industry, 6 female undergraduates were among 10 beneficiaries of an essay competition inaugurated in 2017. In Lagos, Michael Olale, NT News.
President Muhammadu Buhari says his administration is committed to a robust welfare package for all civil servants using the new minimum wage. This was contained in his message at this year's Nigerian Civil Service Week dinner and award night at the State House Conference Center, Abuja.
Onyechi Eberundu, a civil servant, has not allowed her physical challenge affect her productivity and output.
I do not see it as a challenge during my work because I only have a physical disability with my legs and not with my brain.
She proudly joins scores of other civil servants on the honors list for the Presidential Merit Award and special commendation by the head of the Civil Service of the Federation for hard work and integrity in the civil service. With such national recognition, Onyechi and other awardees say they are greatly motivated to put in their best for the nation. Aminu Bisala, who recently retired as permanent secretary in the Ministry of Niger Delta Affairs, was singled out for the Distinguished Presidential Merit Award. He says the civil service has what it takes to drive government's next level agenda.
The service is very rich. All that is required is a little more discipline and then getting holding people accountable.
I wish to appreciate all those who have worked assiduously to deliver on the administration's agenda and implore us all to sustain the tempo of hard work and diligence.
Chairman of the Federal Civil Service Commission, Tukur Ngawa, read President Buhari's address at the dinner.
I also wish to reiterate the unflinching commitment of the administration to provide robust welfare for all civil servants, as aptly demonstrated by the recent Minimum Wage Act and the recent directives to the Honourable Minister of Labour to expedite action on the consequential adjustment negotiations on minimum wage.
The civil service remains the machinery through which all policies and programs of government are implemented. From the Conference Centre, Presidential Villa, Abuja, Mitaire Ikpen, NTA News.
Retelling the Nigerian story is the focus of a documentary festival on show this week to commemorate Nigeria at 59. Fisayo Gunfuyu reports that the event featured an array of new talent in short films and documentaries.
My name is Jesse, and this is now my community.
There are interpretations of a Nigeria they desire. Young documentary producers converged on Abuja to air their artistic impressions of the nation at 59. It is a unique concept, different styles and different focus, fueled by the artistic enthusiasm of young Nigerians determined to give a second view, a positive view of their homeland, while at the same time not glossing over the challenges. With guiding themes on unity and diversity and health coverage for all, the event, which is the brainchild of the African International Documentary Festival Foundation, showcased the vision of the Nigerian youth in film. Three documentarians made it to the podium in the Unity in Diversity mini documentary series, while two won prizes in the universal health coverage category.
As a content creator and a video editor, you know, I love to tell stories. And when I saw this, I felt I need to be part of this.
We want to change the narratives about Africa because a lot of negativity has been said about Africa. We want to tell our stories by ourselves. We don't want people to tell our own stories.
The whole idea is to ensure that those who are underprivileged, who are talents in their own right, who look at our own story and tell our own story.
The foundation also recognized General Ike Nwachukwu and NTA's Director General Malam Yakubu Ibn Mohammed as icons of unity. The AFIDFF, which is a non-governmental and non-profit organization, also launched its program for African documentaries at the event. In Abuja, Fisayo Ogunfuyi, NTA News.
The Department of State Services, DSS, lost two of its personnel in a fatal car accident on Friday, 27th of September. The accident occurred at Gidam Busakatari along the Abuja-Kaduna Expressway. The team was heading to one of the states in the northern part of the country for an operation when the Hilux, which they were in, traveling, somersaulted. A statement from the service says this clarification becomes necessary in order to debunk fake news making the rounds that the gallant officers were attacked by bandits. The public is enjoined to disregard any contrary information. And you are watching Weekend File on the network service of the NTA. Our focus is the 2019 flooding in Nigeria and the efforts of government break. Stay with us.
The public.